Hey everyone, I believe we're good to go here. I'm just going to open the chat. I did in fact get it working last episode. I don't remember if I, last episode I think I had the phone here. Again, you know, it's not perfect, you know, pulling up the phone and stuff during, I was going to turn the volume down so that I can't hear myself and open the chat, and I will just leave the phone there in case any messages pop up. Anyway, let's jump straight into it here. You know what this is at this stage. This is Grounded Mode for The Last of Us on PS4. My favorite game of all time. So last episode was a no-death run. After bigging it up as this terrible thing I would never get through. Never, ever, ever. I was so afraid. I did manage to get through the City Hall section without dying. I was not hustling everyone. I swear to God, that was genuinely the first time I'd ever done that. On the PS3, I tore my goddamn hair out for that section. I really did. That was the first section of Grounded Mode on the PS3 where I was like, okay, you know what? I might not like this. It might be too much. And Tommy's Dam would be the other section, which we'll get to hopefully in a few hours. This episode, we're picking up in the woods here right after we part ways with Tess. We just had the very big cutscene, the very important cutscene, where Joel explicitly says to Ellie, let's not talk about our pasts. You know, big, big character trait for Joel, obviously, is not so much communicating it to other people, but he himself does not want to have to deal with his own shit, basically. Nothing. Spill the shit here.
I've never seen anything like this, that's all.
You mean the woods?
Yeah. Never walked in the woods. Cool.
So this is obviously a gorgeous scene. Absolutely gorgeous. The god rays, of course, a classic effect. We got some animals moving around. Again, you know, it's a very, you know, very Naughty Dog scene. It feels very alive, you know.
I doubt I can get either one of us back into the city in one piece. Trust me. I wish there were some other option.
Look at that water effect. Again, as I mentioned, I didn't get super far in the PS4 version of this. I can't remember if I made it this far. But yeah, look at that water effect. I think Brad Shoemaker on the Giant Bombcast said, this is noticeably a PS3 game in a lot of ways that they've just kind of made look nicer on the PS4. But they put some work in. It is a beautiful looking game. And again, this game pushed the PS3 to its limits back in the day. So we can explore around here for some goodies. I think we got some ammo here. Oh no, it's a crafting utensil. So we have an extended period here of chatting to Ellie.
Hey buddy.
What's she seeing there? Oh, there's a squirrel or something? Yeah. So again, I mean, this is a real showpiece for the kind of the way they tell stories and the way they program the AI in this game. Nothing over here. Because we've got an extended period of just kind of walking around. She's reacting to things. You're not really having to prompt her to look at stuff. It's just kind of, she wanders around with you, kind of doing her own thing. Obviously still within arm's reach of you, but she's kind of reacting to things in her own way. It's a cool sequence. Not a lot of action in this. So obviously we can't get in here. I'll just trigger this just for the sake of it. Yeah.
Oh shit.
Anything over here? No.
Should we climb it?
No. Wire on the top, but we gotta find a way to go around.
I think I have to have that dialogue to trigger this next bit of dialogue, which is obviously very cute.
Fireflies. I mean, real fireflies.
Yeah, I see that.
Yeah, word to Radiohead. I think there's another sequence later in the game where she says that. Yeah, I know, I get it, video game. Yeah, I think there's another sequence later where that exact same thing basically happens. But she's a lot more dour about it. I think it's during spring, during that part of spring where she's very down about what happened in winter. I think that happens. I might be imagining that. Mercifully, they don't go to that well too often. The literal fireflies, that's, you know, they don't overdo that. I think that's pretty much it, except for once more later in the game. So here's where we discover crafted weapons. These are very, very cool. One thing I'd like about this game was it would be really nice if, especially for these higher difficulties, if you could unequip the weapons. So obviously, these weapons that have blades crafted onto them, they are one-hit kills for pretty much everyone except loaders. I think actually... Are they one-hit kills on clickers? I think it depends, but they're pretty devastating. It would be nice if you could unequip them and just use your fists against the lower enemies. So basically, for higher difficulties like this, you want to save your ammo and use melee as much as you can. But if I'm going up against three runners who I can easily take out on my fists, you have to use that first. You can't save it for later. So that's unfortunate, but hey, look, it's better than nothing. It's better than not having them at all, I guess. So we go across here.
There we go.
Again, this is just like the water board. That's a bad term or phrase. The board used to cross the water. This is educating you on a puzzle you're going to do a lot in this game.
Huh? Different places.
You've never been here, have you?
I know this is where he lives, but no, I ain't never been here personally.
And that smoke, you think that's him?
Sure as hell better be.
Well, let's go.
So again, I think I mentioned in the last episode, this is kind of when the game really, for lack of a better term, gets good. I don't want to act like the first 2 hours or 3 hours isn't good, because I think they are. But, you know, having played this game several times, I think it's fair to say that they are the kind of... I think it's the, you know, the weakest part of the game is the first hour. I mean, you have that great prologue with Sarah, which is great. And then after that, it's like, you know, it's slow, it's tutorializing, it's leading you by the hand. Tess is a great character, but she's very much tied to a very slow-moving part of the game. I feel like visually, obviously, this is a great-looking area. Bill, who we're going to meet shortly, is a very cool character. There's lots of stuff to interact with. There's lots of great set pieces. There's lots of stealth. There are clickers here, so I'm going to be quiet. We're introduced to some new game mechanics. Like, I think we get the first training manual in Bill's hideout. So about 45 minutes from now. So we're like nearly 4 hours into the game and we're still learning stuff about the game. So one interesting thing about Last of Us is it is actually it's a pretty long game relative to other AAA games. So this is technically still kind of a tutorial area in the sense that when we get to Bill's, we're still learning aspects of the game. Now, I need to be super quiet here because their hearing on this difficulty is insane. Ellie. Okay, I know, like, enemy AI can't detect her when we're in sneaky mode. But the fact that she sprints around still sets me off. Is there anything in there? It really looks like something is in there. So there's another one over there, so I can't even really, it's not worth fighting them. It's just not on this difficulty, not with the restrictions that I have ammo-wise. So I might try and lure them out before I leave the area to see if there is anything in there. Again, there are items that spawn in that shed, with that clicker. But on this difficulty, it's not consistent. You can't guarantee that they're going to be there. So I'll wait until the last minute before I fight them. More pills.
Are you all right?
Weapons away.
I don't know how to whistle.
You don't know how to whistle.
Well, does it sound like I know how to whistle?
This game is pretty fucking dour, which some people are kind of critical of, especially since the heads of this game are now working on Uncharted. I think this game has a ton of heart. It has a great sense of humor. That's an example right there. I mean, they go back to that whistling thing like half a dozen times between now and the end of the game. And it's really well done. I really appreciate it an awful lot. It's one of those little touches that kind of shows these characters interacting in a way that's kind of endearing. So that when Joel eventually comes around on Ellie and he eventually kind of decides he doesn't want to ditch her. He sees enough in her that he wants to stick with her. It makes sense because she's endearing herself to him throughout the game. So I, as miserable as this game can be, it is full of heart. This is a first note from Bill, and I think it references Tess. Next drop off with Tess, yeah. So again, I'm not going to collect all of those. There's a shit ton of stuff to find in this area with Bill. It is not insignificant. But we'll be here forever if we do that. I'm not going to do a running commentary on every single aspect of the game. Although I could. I fucking love this game, man. What can I say? So there's a shiv door down here. So what I'm going to do is, we've cleared out that area. There's a shiv door down here. I'm going to open that. I'm going to hoist Ellie up over that. Can I hoist her over that before I myself walk through the gate? I'll see about that. But yeah, let's do the shiv door first. Basically, what I'm saying is I'm gonna wait till the last second before I lure those clickers out. By the way, one thing I thought was pretty funny about two best friends play, Matt and Pat. They have a playthrough of this game, which was very entertaining. One thing I liked about it is that whistling conversation. It happens within a couple of feet of those clickers, and she's being all playful. You know, like, and those clickers are still alive, and it's just there's a bit of a dissonance. This is the nitpickiest of the nitpicky, but there is a bit of a dissonance between kind of some of the ambient conversations that the characters can have and the fact that there's sound based enemies in this fucking world, you know.
Shit. It's jammed from the other side.
Here, boost me up.
That's not such a good idea.
Well, I can't boost you up. How else are we gonna get over there?
Yeah, so what else? Something else I wanted to make. Oh, okay, so there's a shiv door I mentioned in the previous episodes. Always worth it. Even though I didn't get much there. I used the pills to upgrade my weapon sway, which is vital. Vital, vital, vital. It's vital on every difficulty, but on this difficulty, especially when ammo is at a premium, the weapon sway of this game is ridiculous. So you should upgrade it as quickly as you can. That should be your main focus, honestly. Okay, so I'm able to, actually, what I'm going to do here is, I believe the pipe, yeah, so the pipe drops, so that one is the lethal one, so I'm going to take this one back, and I'm going to clear out those fucking, I'm going to clear out those fucking clickers. Where's your buddy? Okay, so his buddy got hung up on some geometry there, and I died. And we're back to the start. Alrighty. This is the beef with this fucking difficulty. I mentioned this in a previous episode, like, hey, person in the chat. This is what I mentioned about the difficulty, grounded, is I have to go and collect all the stuff I just collected again. Is that really a difficulty thing, or is it an inconvenience thing? I think it's pretty inconvenient. It's part of why I really don't like this difficulty. So I got to go through this. She's probably going to do her stupid whistling conversation again. You know, let me just pick all this stuff up. Blah, blah, blah.
I'm trying to learn how to whistle.
Blah, blah, blah. Gears. Tess's note. Blah, blah, blah. That's a pain, but what can you do? So let's do the shiv door again. Let's throw her over the fence. I feel like I'm not the only one who kind of had that criticism. I'm kind of surprised they didn't change it for the PS4 version or patch it or something like that. I just don't feel like the checkpoints thing. I think I'm not alone on it. I think a lot of people just don't like that aspect of this difficulty. And now see, I have to sit through this dialogue that I've already heard. Like, simple things like, just give me a checkpoint after the dialogue. You know what I mean? It's not asking too much, I don't think. What I'm going to do, I'm going to ignore those two clickers. It's not worth it. I don't think there was anything in that room, so. And if there is, I mean, look. Let's cut our losses here and just...
Okay.
Thanks, Ellie.
Good job.
So here we have a big ass open area and some nice music coming in.
So let's see, we get a car from this buddy of yours.
Then don't interrupt me, Ellie.
Well, then we go find Tommy.
Marlene said he's your brother?
And more importantly, he was a firefly. He know where to take you.
Okay.
He lives far from here, which is why we need the car.
So yeah, there's your little plot reminder.
Gnomes.
Yeah, those were gnomes.
Man, I had an art book filled
with them. Look how creepy that is.
I always thought they were super cute. Not fairies, though. They creep me out.
All right, man.
Just Joel just completely, like, unable or unwilling to just deal with this lighthearted conversation about fucking gnomes. Again, you know, I talked earlier about kind of... Oh, yeah, I forgot to... Oh, I didn't upgrade the weapons, sorry. I talked earlier about kind of, you know, their growing relationship over time and stuff. And how it's really evident even early on, but we are still early on, so he's still kind of not really up for it. This area is completely optional. This is the wrong direction. Progress is the other way. But I got that little conversation. I got pills. On a lower difficulty, there'd be more ammo and stuff there. I think that is a major feather in this game's cap compared to Uncharted, is lots of places to look around, lots of conversations to have. I mentioned I'm not going to do every single optional conversation, obviously. In this area, I kind of have to do a lot of them because there is a lot of exploring to be done here, and if you don't do the exploring, you will miss out on ammo and stuff like that and resources. So that's... Plus, I do want to do some of the conversations because I think they're neat. Like, this one here is actually one of the... Like, this one was mentioned in reviews an awful lot as a really cool moment. And it is a really cool moment.
Would you play this before?
No. But I had a friend that knew everything about this game. Apparently, there's this character called Angel Knives who... She'd punch a hole through your stomach before kicking your head off.
I was never a big fan of these things.
I wish I could play it.
Yeah, there's so much cool stuff about this. First of all, obviously, Joel, like, you know, not a big fan of these things. She's talking about how violent it is. Last of Us was a very kind of, I suppose ponderous is a word you could use. Ponderous about violence in games. I mean, it is kind of interestingly constructed in the sense that, it treats death and violence in a less kind of gratuitous way. I mean, there's a lot of it, but it's given a bit of weight. Obviously, she references Riley, which we'll see more of in Left Behind. The character here from The Turning, who Riley tells Ellie about and talks about how great this character is, kind of looks a bit like Riley. So it's kind of like deitizing Riley in Ellie's mind as this superhero, this video game character. She looks a bit like her. She's kind of a young kind of black teenage girl who kind of has a bit of a soldier aura about her, which is very much what Riley is, because Riley is a firefly. I mean, just so much attention to detail. You know, really, really well done. Left Behind, I've said it a couple times already, is a fantastic piece of DLC. It's really well done. So yeah, that little conversation is referenced in a lot of reviews, written and video reviews for this game, because it kind of illustrates just how far they go with the conversations and how cute some of them can be, for lack of a better term. I mean, that's a very nod, wink, wink conversation, you know, a violent video game. Yeah. So over here we have again a testament to one of the more open areas in the game. Is it in here? Where is it? Oh, there it is. There's a couple of these in the game. We saw one already in the train station. You can find safes and other locked boxes throughout the world, and it's kind of up to you to find the code.
What do you think? Quarantine zone. See, some places got a heads up before the infection showed up. Most didn't.
Man, must be hard. Just... leaving all your stuff behind like that.
That ain't the hard part.
Yeah. Yeah. That's one of those lines that's a bit kind of like, hey, you know, as profound and kind of intelligent as we make Ellie, she's also kind of like naive. She's still a kid, you know, like she thinks the worst thing about it is leaving your shit behind. But yeah, so again, a kind of testament. It's not this isn't fucking GTA or anything, but the levels are open enough that they can kind of discreetly hide that the code to that safe. It's down here. I'll go fetch it. Also, as an aside, speaking of fetching things, if you wanted to climb up that RV up there, there is a firefly pendant. I'm not going to bother because I'm not collecting those. As I mentioned before, there's no in-game incentive for finding those, so I'm not going to bother. So this is Bill's handiwork.
As I know, it's just him.
So yeah, there's, you know, again, there's some flavor text, characters communicating to each other about the safe, but we don't need to read it. And the good thing is, you don't have to enter the safe code, nor do you have to remember it. You don't actually. I could have gone back to the safe without even reading that thing. You just know the combination, and so I can just go and open it. That's a nice touch. More pills, more parts. I've got a lot of parts now. Okay, so we went in there. We got the safe. I think if you get that firefly pendant, Ellie says something to the effect of, are any of the fucking fireflies alive? Which is an interesting bit of foreshadowing, because all we've seen is dead ones so far. This is another very praised conversation piece, Ellie going through the music here, which you'll see in just a moment.
Look at this place.
Yeah, perimeter. I thought that was a resource, not a note. I'm not going to read it. All the notes you find in this area are Bill, like, leaving notes to himself, like, fucking tighten the perimeter, put up more blocking, you know,
man,
stuff like that.
Sad.
What is?
All this music that's just sitting here. No one's around to listen to it. I don't know. It doesn't seem right.
Again, kind of a nice touch. Not really for the... I mean... I guess there are a lot of PS3 games that neglect this kind of thing, but she doesn't just stand and look at the records and say her lines. They went to the bother of animating her going through it and having individually moving pieces in the records. Again, I'm not touting that as some kind of amazing technological achievement, but it's a nice touch. She, you know, I hate to use this word because it's a real cliche, but in the immersion that people go on and on about in video games, she's, you know, behaving in a way that's not just a video game character saying lines. So we're going to see one of Bill's traps go off here.
Jesus!
Whoa, Nelly! What the hell was that?
That would be one of Bill's traps.
Your friend a bit paranoid, maybe?
That's putting it lightly.
Deal with this guy.
Well, he helped us smuggle stuff into the cities. He knows how to find things.
Well, let's hope we don't blow up trying to find him.
Just watch your step, you'll be fine.
Here's another shiv door. This is what I'm talking about in terms of,
you gotta teach me how to do that.
On this difficulty, try your best to not engage clickers, because you're going to want to use those shivs. You're going to want to use them. There's a trophy for getting all the shiv doors, and I think that's a pretty good trophy because some of them are well hidden. Like, you could, like, if a door is closed in Last of Us, the majority of them you just can't be opened. They're either, you know, if most doors look like that, they're open for progress. So it's easy to miss the shiv doors. I'm very cautious of my volume here. I did get the trophy for all of them, so I think I know where they all are, but that's not a guarantee. I could easily miss them. But if I want to do well on this mode, I probably should do my best to get them all.
I reckon he is.
Yeah. So I was kind of worried during these early scenes. I was like, is Bill going to be a wacky character? And he kind of is, but he's a great character. He's not too over the top. One of my favorite characters in the game, actually. He's not over the top comedic, but he's kind of comedy. What's the term I'm looking for? Comic relief. I fumbled over my words there. I'm not sure what's up with me. So we get the bow here. Isn't there usually a body here? Maybe I'm mistaken.
Let me use that.
leave this kind of stuff to me.
Well, we could both be armed. Cover each other.
I don't think so.
Yeah. I don't think they ever address why she is such a good shot. Do they? They show where she gets her bow in the winter chapter in Left Behind, but I don't. Another example, she's a goddamn Mary Sue. Am I right, everybody? I fucking hate the Mary Sue argument. I hate the Mary Sue argument in every genre and about every film or game or show. I fucking hate it in general. I mean, no, stop picking it up. Alright, gotta move it further, okay. There. Okay. Fucking climb the goddamn ladder. Oh, it's X climb the ladder. My bad. Okay. I've only beaten this game 6 or 7 times. The first time you do this, obviously, there's kind of a reveal that you're doing a puzzle and you have to go back for that, but I'm saving myself some time here. The bow is a really cool weapon when you get used to it. It has a pretty steep learning curve to the point that some people... Some kind of Let's Players and some reviewers on YouTube I saw shit-talking it, which is fine. I mean, look, not everyone's going to play this game to the insane degree I did. I have fixed my weapon sway, so this should be doable.
Let's give this baby a whirl.
Try my best here. I am unsure what the... rules are in terms of when the arrows break and when they don't. I have no idea.
Of individuals. So when we get there, you let me do the talking. You understand?
I understand.
You gotta be clear on this. You don't take too kindly to strangers.
Alright.
Bill's a good guy. You just definitely need some time warming up to you.
I love this building up of Bill as this fucking maniac. And he kind of is. I get it. Go down, Joel. There you go. So the bow... sometimes the arrows break, other times they don't. I don't really get it. I've played this game a lot. I've never properly understood what the rules are. I think if you miss... most times it breaks. And if you hit, it's like 50-50, I guess. So, there is one infected in here.
Shit, you're gonna go in there?
I wanna see what we can find.
You're gonna find my body when I die from a heart attack.
Don't worry. I got this.
Great bit of dialogue. I love the sound design in this game. I mentioned before about how scary it is, and I do feel it is a genuinely very scary game. Just the pounding on the door and then the running up the stairs in the distance, it's all so well done. So I'm going to use the brick here to take this guy out, because I want to save my lethal strike on the pipe. Come on, buddy. Boom. Pills, glorious pills. You're gross, buddy. Well, by the way, Ellie reacts to the flashlight, by the way, so I'm going to turn that off. Again, a little touch. I think before I go over and read that note to Rachel, I think Ellie goes over and looks at it first. So let me see if there's anything in the kitchen before I do that. It does not appear there. Oh, that is gross. Yeah. So this is neat. So she looks at it. And now I go over and I read it. The gist of this one here is this is a, soldiers are here. I got to go to the quarantine zone. We'll meet you. I'll meet you there. This is from Ezra, who's a guy, to Rachel.
You think they ever found each other?
How would I know?
Well, I'd like to think they did.
Such a great answer to that question. How would I know? Joel is like not up for this bullshit to any degree yet. Even though he's had his moments of looking at Ellie and thinking she's not too bad, he's still just completely unwilling to just buy into this. So that, again, that area is kind of rich with stuff if you get there on a lower difficulty. Sorry, my ear is bugging me. If you get there and you're playing on lower difficulty, it's worth the gamble. It's worth going in and taking that guy out. Plus, he's just a runner. On a lower difficulty, he means nothing. Let me get another bottle here. Alrighty. So we're coming up to a kind of infinite ammo set piece. Yeah. So basically, they're building us up with ammo for this gun because coming up next is the hanging upside down set piece of defending yourself against the infected. Even though they are giving you lots of ammo, you kind of have more ammo than they let you on to believe. It's not quite infinite. I'm not sure what the rules are, because you can run out of ammo in this next section. I guess it's just kind of, they want it to feel believably like you're actually using your real life resources, when in actuality, I don't believe you are. If anyone knows the answer to that, feel free to tweet me or post a comment here. Are you using your actual ammo stocks in this next sequence, or is it infinite? So I've got 16. I guarantee you I'm going to shoot more than 16 times in this next scene. So yeah. So again, it's kind of video gamey set piece logic, kind of like when you get on a turret in other games and the turret doesn't have ammo for some reason, it's just infinite. It's the same here. I have to defend myself in this section. If you're ever playing the section on grounded, don't worry about your ammo. You have to defend yourself. You'll die straight away if you don't shoot at every opportunity. And as I say, I'm pretty sure it's not infinite, but they are more generous with the ammo here. This first section is actually the hardest. The second section, you have to protect Ellie. Ellie doesn't have one hit kills. Nothing kills her in one shot. You, however, are vulnerable. I'm vulnerable to everything. Runners will kill me in one hit. Clickers will kill me in one hit. So I gotta fucking do my best here. I'm done. Yeah. Okay. So yeah, the next section. So basically, once I defend myself, and I gotta defend Ellie. Come on. I don't think that's there on the lower difficulties. I'm pretty sure you just start straight away at the shooting gallery. I might be wrong on that one. Can I skip this? I can't. I don't want to build stupid traps. So yeah, the second stage, basically, if Ellie's in danger, she gets that health bar above her head. It's short on the higher difficulty, but it's perfectly manageable. That section is not hard at all. This one is tough. Again, dying on this mode is just punishing. I have to watch that dialogue. I have to watch the hanging upside down cutscene. Can I reload here straight away? Oh, there we go. Oh, fucking Christ. Okay. I'm going to turn this down so I can...
Stupid traps.
Sorry, I was just making sure that I thought I was having audio coming through my TV again, which is something a mistake I keep making. Okay. Again, it's just like if you're gonna make a difficulty that's all around, that's heavily based around one hit kills, make the checkpoint after the conversation. It's so tiresome. And again, it's not a difficulty thing. Like, I'm not annoyed by the one hit kill. I'm annoyed by having to sit through the same dialogue, three or four times, or however many times it's going to take me to do this. So basically, I got to reload at every opportunity here.
Ellie!
so I'm good here. So I think if she dies, I go all the way back to the start of the, like, that cutscene again. But as I mentioned, she's a lot easier to protect than I am, ironically enough.
Damn it.
Alrighty. And here's our buddy. So here's a trick, a mistake a lot of people make in the first time they play this. Just go here. Bill kind of, during this rescue scene, he kind of leads you around the world for sport. Like, oh, go this way, go that way. No, there's infected here. The door is right here, and everything else is basically... Everything else is basically a distraction. Bill is more than capable of defending himself. Let's go. Cutscene door. This is a great cutscene. I think I'll be quieter in this one.
Thanks for the heroics and all. Ellie. Hey, what are you... Joel?
Bill!
What are you doing?
Bill! Turn around and get on your knees.
Just calm down a second.
Turn around
all right.
And get on your knees! Don't test me!
Just take it easy.
Any bites?
No.
Anything sprouting?
Oh, God damn it, I'm clean!
If I see so much as a trick. Ow! Stop! Son of a bitch!
You done?
Am I done?
Just made sure to mute myself while I was stuffing
my
fat face.
You set off all my traps. You damn near break my shooting arm. Who the fuck is this punk and what's she doing here?
I am none of your goddamn business, and we're here because you owe Joel some favors. And you can start by taking these off.
I owe Joel some favors. Is this some kind of joke?
I'll cut to the chase. I need a car.
Well, it is a joke. Joel needs a car. Well, if I had one that works, which I sure as hell don't, what makes you think I'd just give it to you? Huh? Yeah, sure, Joel. Go ahead. Take my car. Take all my food, too, while you're at it.
By the looks of it, you could lose some of that food.
Listen to me, you little shit.
No, fuck you! You handcuff me!
I need you to shut up. All right?
Whatever favors you think I owe you ain't worth that much.
Actually, Bill, they are.
Well, it don't matter, because I don't have a car that works.
But there is one in this town.
Parts. There are parts in this town.
Meaning that you could fix one up.
All right. If I'm gonna do this, there's some gear I'm gonna need.
All right.
It's on the other side of town. Now you help me go gather it, and maybe I can put something together that runs. But after this, I owe you nothing.
That's fine. A couple of days from now, we'll probably be dead anyway.
Good.
Nice.
Follow me.
Good outlook to have, I think.
Goddamn town's booby trap. Best stay right on my ass.
Can't miss it.
Knock it off.
Oh, Ellie, you scamp.
All right. Whatever supplies you may want or need, I suggest you grab them.
All right, thank you. Ellie, take a look around, see if there's anything we can use.
I think this pipe is stronger than my... Yeah, so I used this one a couple of times, so we can do that. Recurring trend in this game, cutscene objects that you can collect. Here's Bill's map he just showed us in the cutscene. Later in the game, there's other things. The best example is when you find the Firefly in the Fall chapter, who the very cynical one who's like, if you came here looking for us, they fucked off to a different hospital and I'm going to die. And the one where Joel like fast forwards looking for the location of the hospital. You can open that after the fact and listen to the whole tape. It's like 5 minutes long. I really like that. I love that, you know, he slams down the map in the cutscene and it's there. You can pick it up and look at it in greater detail. Just a nerdy piece of useless trivia. So let's explore around here for some goodies. Got another note. Not going to bother reading. Again, it's just, you know, tighten the perimeter, blah, blah, blah. No, don't look at that. I want to... my head is starting to hurt me. Not in the game, in real life. I'm just coming off a few days off work with a migraine. And so, of course, my first day medically cleared, so to speak, I'm playing video games. I was back to work today. I was glad to be back, but it is starting to bother me a little bit now.
He's got a fucking stick up his ass.
Just stay out of his way.
Yeah. So here's the thing about these two. I think I mentioned this in like the very first episode. You don't want to really put anything in these two in any mode in general, I would say. You should craft and heal when you're in a safe spot. Now, sometimes healing, you gotta do it when you're not in a super safe spot, so the speed does matter. Fair enough. I just don't think these two are really worth it. I only do this stuff when you're safe to do it. Maximum health is a great thing to invest in on any difficulty other than this. There are too many one-hit kill enemies in this game, I feel. Although, you know, I mean, I wonder if it's still a one-hit kill if I upgrade my health. I actually don't know, because Grounded is the one thing I haven't done. I haven't finished, so I don't know. I'm not going to do either of these two. Shivmaster, I'm not going to do, because I'm only going to have so many shivs during the course of this game. And I'm going to use them all on doors. So Shivmaster lets you protect yourself from a clicker. If they grab you, you can shiv them last second. You know what? I'm going to take a risk, and I'm going to invest in maximum health. Because I don't care about these two, and I guess I'm not going to use this one either. Weapon sway and maximum health are the only two I really give a shit about. So, and I'm gonna, there's more than enough pills. The pill quantity does not change regardless of difficulty. So there is enough for me to do here. So I'm going to continue gathering supplies, as Bill calls them. Where is the training manual? I believe it's there it is. Shivs upgraded, they last one hit longer. That doesn't really apply to us, because a shiv door, that takes a full shiv. You don't get to keep. So if I... Where are my shivs? Okay, yeah, so one shiv now has two hits. So I can kill two clickers with it, but that does not apply to shiv doors. A shiv door is always, always, always one full shiv. So this is a cute little thingy.
Bobby Fisher, don't touch anything on that board.
Bobby, what?
Just let it go.
I had no idea who Bobby Fisher was the first time I played this game. That joke went right over my head. I have since found out who it was. Presumably he was playing with Frank. I mean, that's what I would guess.
Found everything you need.
We're good.
There's also a trophy in this game, I believe, for collecting all the training manuals. You're going to want to collect those anyway. They're pretty cool. They tend to upgrade your items rather than your character, I think.
Stay with me.
Can't believe you agreed.
Sean McGee's telling me to fuck myself in the chat. Well, he's just a hater, because this is a smooth, well-playing game and not some obtuse piece of Japanese garbage. That's masquerading as intentionally hard, when in actual fact it is poorly made. And anyway, let's get back to this, a good video game. Let me see here. Yeah, so the training manual is kind of upgrade your items rather than your character. So it's, you know, upgrades the Molotovs, upgrades smoke bombs, all that kind of stuff. So yeah, Bill and Ellie are bantering back and forth here. I'm not listening because I'm gathering supplies and I'm talking to Sean in the chat.
So where are we going, Bill?
My other safe house. More of an armory.
Wait, I thought we were going to fix up a car.
We?
Bill.
It's like I said, what I need's on the other side of town. Now that side I don't ever go to because it's filled with infected. So we're going to need more guns.
So, I talked all over it and butchered it, but their interplay is actually really good. I really, really like this chapter of the game. I think Bill's really cool. Sean's telling me to play Bloodborne. I don't have it anymore. I gave it up because I didn't like it. Leave me alone. You know what? I might revisit Bloodborne. We'll see. But anyway. Ellie and Bill really, really enjoy it. Bill's one of those characters that I would like to say, oh, he should be in the game more, but that's actually, I don't like it when people say that. Like, I think it's good when a cool character comes in, has a couple of cool scenes, and then fucks off. You don't want them hanging around like a bad smell and then kind of outstaying their welcome, because he's not an important character. He's a cool character, but he's not an important character. So let's, if I wanted to, I could kill this lady before he does, but ammo is at a premium.
Yeah, I thought the two of you were inseparable.
Sorry, lady.
Busy. Yeah, sure. Busy. Like that. Might be trouble in paradise.
Yeah, something like that.
Gross. Listen to that sound effect. That sound effect is ridiculous. Alright, now we have a tough section, but there's a couple of mean characters in this next section that we gotta fight. It's an obligatory fight. You cannot avoid it. You cannot sneak around it. You cannot stealth your way out of it. You gotta fight these guys.
You're a genius. I mean, the whole time, why on earth hadn't I thought about fixing one of these cars?
Okay, don't be a dick.
Their tires are rotted and their batteries are dead.
Are you done?
Can't even begin to think what the inside of the engine block look like. Only ones making new car batteries are the military.
So I broke the game a little bit there by looking directly at them before they triggered, you know. I love Bill's kill animations are so fucking cool. He's literally just chopping heads off and fucking people up. Alrighty. We got another brick over here. I believe we do. Shut up, Bill. I'm fucking coming, you pussy. What's that? You can't melee clickers? Well, I just did. There's another Firefly pendant up there if you care, but I don't. I mean, Bill and Joel's interactions are pretty funny, too, in the sense that they sound like they know each other and are kind of sick of each other. And here comes a pretty interesting bit of dialogue.
You picked a hell of a place to hold up, didn't you?
You know, as bad as those things are, at least they're predictable. Normal people that scare me. You of all people should understand that.
What does that mean?
I like you, Ellie, but you're not very perceptive. That is a very not subtle nod to, hey, Joel, aren't humans the real monster? Am I right or am I right? Yeah. I mean, it's a good theme, but like every piece of zombie fiction in the history of time has had a nod to the fact that humans are worse than zombies. But hey.
We're here. It's in the cellar.
There is a workbench in this area, I do believe. Thankfully, I've been working up a whole bunch of those supplies, so let's trigger another. This is a pretty cool cutscene in here of just Bill and Joel shooting the shit.
Well, here we are. You don't touch anything. And you close the door. gear up.
What? I need a gun?
No, you don't.
Joel, I can handle myself.
No. Just stay here.
It's fine. Just wait around for you two to get me killed.
Well, this goes on record as the worst fucking job you've ever taken.
It's up there.
How in the hell is Tess okay with this suicide mission?
Actually, her idea.
Really? Well, the broad's not as smart as I thought she was.
Just Bill, just shit talking the woman we possibly love, who's fucking dead.
Get back to where you found her.
I can't just take her back.
Then send her packing. Let her find her own way. But let me tell you a story. Once upon a time, I had somebody that I cared about.
He's talking about Frank.
Partner. Somebody I had to look after. And in this world, that sort of shit's good for one thing. Getting you killed. So you know what I did? I wisened the fuck up. And I realized it's gotta be just me.
Bill, obviously, you can piece together the fact that him and Frank have two different versions of what happened, you know?
Hey! What'd I say to you when we walked down the steps? What'd I say?
I'm just fixing your stupid pile.
Don't touch. God damn it. You keep babysitting long enough and eventually it's gonna blow up in
Bill,
your face.
Can we please just get on with it?
Here. Let's get on with it.
So as good as that cutscene is, it's super gratifying the first time you get to this part of the game, and oh yeah, the gun porn happens. Yeah. Also,
before we go any further, I got something I gotta show you.
What you got?
A new toy from the toy box. The bombs. A nail bomb, that was it.
This is a nail bomb. You gotta be really careful. This thing blows, it shreds anybody standing nearby.
Look at that gnarly fucking thing. Basically... you can place them. I never found a use for placing them in single player. In multiplayer, which I might do, I might stream some multiplayer just for fun at some point. This is 101 advanced Last of Us play. Placing bombs at critical points in the map. Never found a use for it in single player. And they also just work like traditional grenades. Just hold them and throw. Not the best weapon in the game. I think the Molotov is kind of the go-to for a lot of people, but it's good to have it.
We got shotguns and bombs. What the hell are we doing with them?
Well, every few weeks this military caravan rides through town. I assume they're out looking for supplies. I mean, you'd be amazed at the shit that they overlook. Anyway, a few months back, they were rolling through and they get overrun by this horde of infected. They were all over the truck. It plows right in the side of the high school. Still sitting there with the battery in it.
So we take that battery and we put it in another car.
Bingo! I wanted to get it, but it seemed too dangerous with all the infected on that part of town. But fuck it. Joel needs a car.
What if it's damaged?
Nah. Those trucks are like tanks.
I love that delivery.
Just sitting there.
Actually, my work.
It's just, I mean... Yeah. I don't want to go on about it, but... Just great delivery, great direction, great lines. Great voice actors. Joel needs a car. Alright, so this is... both in cutscene terms and in actual terms, this is where we beef our shit up, because there's more tools over here to upgrade our weapons. These are very easily missed. Are those the first tools? Have I missed a pair? No, those are the first tools, I do believe. You need those to upgrade your weapons, which we will see in uno momento. Let me see here. Before I go to the bench, let me see if I've got anything else here. Okay, I think, yeah, slim fucking pickings, obviously, on this difficulty, so... Let us take a look. Alright. I mentioned that this is a good gun if you invest some time in it. You should invest time and you should invest resources in it. Do I wanna... The shotgun obviously is a fucking beast. go reload speed on this one. And let's go reload speed on this one. And let's go scope on this one. Clip capacity, that's a good one. I think that thing has one shot before it has to reload, typically. Let's go range and draw speed. And again, so I mentioned how this is a piece of crap and you shouldn't bother upgrading it because it should be your last resort. It should be your last resort or your kind of disposable weapon. If you're coming up against some tough enemies and you want to just use this to dispose of some runners, that's what you use this gun for. You don't use it for anything else. By ignoring all of these, which at that first table, it's very easy to, you know, excitedly dump all your stuff in here. I've got tons of ammo, or I've got tons of parts really to play around with here. Recoil, not a big factor in this. I mean, reload speed is a great thing to change for every weapon. So okay, see, I think we're not maxed out, but so I can invest in recoil if I want. Again, I'm gonna kind of play it strategic here, and I'm gonna hold back on that at the moment. Can I upgrade anything else here? No. Yeah, I don't have the tools. Again, that's a tip really for every difficulty of this is don't feel the need to spend all your gears at every desk. So let's keep going here. Is there a melee weapon over here? I think there. I guess not in this difficulty.
Kid, I swear to God, if you took anything.
Hey man, I don't need any of your shit. Trust me.
Joel, you are keeping an eye on her, right?
Like a hawk.
So yeah, there's the magazine she steals. I guess he might have two copies. Anything down here? I do not believe so. So I'm going to go up and have the next couple of conversations, pick up the next couple of collectibles. Is the magazine gone? No? Okay. And then I'm going to call it here. And then we will take on the school, which is a tough level. By the way, so I have one explosive, one bomb rather, and I have the resources to make another one. I'm actually not going to do that because it uses up blades. And blades are needed for shivs. I currently do not have a shiv, so I'm gonna hold out on that for the moment. So let me just explore here and make sure. Nope.
Wow.
Nice place you got here.
Well, if you got anything to confess, this would be the place to do it. That's not the confessional booth. That's my room.
All right, I'm not touching anything.
Yeah, so more notes. It's kind of weird. You want to go into his room. You do, because it's got pills in there. Again, this has ammo and shit on lesser difficulties. So let's keep going here.
All right. Time to sack up.
Come on.
Look, there's a school.
All right.
Ready?
Guess we'll find out.
All righty. Yeah, so I'm gonna wrap up here. This next section's kind of tough. Getting through the quaint little town on the way to the school. There's a fucking ton of enemies, and there in this next section there's gonna be a fucking major conflict between just get through the level to get to the next section and explore for goodies. because there are goodies to be had in the houses in the neighborhood we're about to go through, but the next area is absolutely swamped with enemies, and the extra jam is that the school where we're going to, that is also jam packed with enemies. So I'm gonna want those supplies in preparation for the school, but I'll cross that when I get to it. So that was another episode. Not a death-free episode like the last one was, unfortunately. First of all, I had the clicker kill me at the very, very beginning of Bill's Town, stupidly. And I had my share of debts there in the Upside Down set piece. But yeah, we're making steady progress. I'm feeling more confident about this than I was in the PS3 version, I think because I'm kind of more familiar with it now. Thanks for watching. Subscribe, all that other jazz, you know how it goes. More of this in the coming days and weeks. Peace out.